Hey guys, how you doing? This is Steve from New Creation in Christ. Hope you guys are having a blessed day. As always, this channel is all about glorifying our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and leading people to Him, strengthening and encouraging my brothers and sisters in Christ, and leading unbelievers to salvation should they so choose to do that. So that's what this is all about, guys. It's all about Him, not about me. So let's get into this. Today I'm going to be talking about theistic evolution. This is going to be part one of two, maybe three parts, depending on how far I decide to go with it. But as you all know, I am not a believer in theistic evolution. Make that very clear right off the bat. I do not believe that it's biblical, and I don't believe that it is evolution is compatible with the Bible. So, in any way, shape, or form. Of course, one of the main promoters of theistic evolution is William Lane Craig, and of course, if you've been on my channel for any length of time, you know how I feel about his teaching. I do not agree with it. I don't think any believer does themselves any favor by listening to what he has to say, and that's about as blunt as I can be with it. You know, theistic evolution isn't even the only problem with his teaching. He believes in neo-Apollinarianism, which denies the humanity and sinlessness of Christ. And in denying the sinlessness of Christ, he cannot be the perfect atonement for our sins. And of course, denying his humanity, you know, if Christ wasn't human, he couldn't even die. He couldn't even die and rise again. So that completely nullifies the gospel message. And of course, the Bible is very specific when it talks about people who deny the humanity of Christ, and it's not good. It's not good. So, having said all of that, he also denies original sin, and that's the reason why Christ came to die for us. So, I would not suggest going to him for any type of biblical advice. Having said that, let's move on. One of the main focuses of theistic evolution is a non-literal approach to Scripture. Why do we take God's Word literally? And the main reason, the number one reason, above all else, we take it literally because Christ and the apostles took it literally. When Christ was speaking about the flood, he said, "As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be when the Son of Man returns." He was talking about the flood as a literal event. When we look at the Apostle Paul, he's dealing with a literal Adam. So when he's comparing Adam to Christ and Christ as the second Adam, he also uses examples from the Old Testament like Abraham and talked about them as real people. Then you look at Peter in 2 Peter 2 verses 5 through 7. Peter deals with the global flood as a real event. So that's the primary reason why we take a literal interpretation of the Bible, is because Christ, our Lord and Savior, and the apostles did as well. So, also a big number two, you know, if you don't take the Bible literally, you can make the Bible say anything you want it to say, and that's not a good thing. Human beings have many opinions, and you know, we should go by what the Bible says, because God's opinion stands firm forever. So, having said all of that, guys, also another thing to note, when I say taking a literal interpretation of the Bible, it's important to understand that there are certain parts of the Bible that are metaphorical, but we always look for a literal interpretation first, unless the verse forces us into a metaphorical interpretation. I like to use this example as an example of one that we should take metaphorically. It's when Jesus says he is the door, right? We know Jesus is not a literal wooden door. We know that he is the door to salvation. He is the door to the Father. And so that's an example of one that we would not take literally. Genesis 1 through 11 does not fit that category. Genesis 1 through 11 is not mytho-history. That's not how the writers intended it to be taken as. You know, Scripture is meant to be interpreted as the Word of God. 2 Timothy 3, verses 16 and 17 state that very specifically. that this was not written like the Iliad or mythologies of the past. It was written with the intent of giving us the very word of God. So that's important to know. So, having said all of that, guys, you know my thoughts on theistic evolution. You know my thoughts on how to interpret the Bible. Let's get into answers in Genesis and got questions, and let's see what they have to say on theistic evolution. So let's start with AIG, Answers in Genesis. I love Answers in Genesis. Very, very much supportive of them. They have a great channel, guys. I would encourage anyone to subscribe to them. Good stuff. All right, what do they have to say? Number one, the essence of theistic evolution is God started it all, and he is still watching over the creation. Regardless of any good intentions, theistic evolutionists twist scripture and weaken the fabric of biblical doctrine. And why do they weaken it? Because they're changing it at a whim. They're changing it on a whim and at the drop of a hat. Whatever they need the Bible to fit, and that's how they interpret it. And that's not the right way to interpret scripture, guys. You know, the Bible is not there for us to just make God into whoever we want him to be. God is not, you know, some fit-in-the-box kind of God. You know, God is who he is, and you're not doing anybody any favors by giving them an impression of God that isn't true. So, let's move on. Number two, theistic evolution is the idea that God started or directed evolutionary processes. This view makes God a bumbling, incompetent creator and the author of death and suffering as it puts them before mankind's sin. It calls into question the truth of God's word and his character as an all-powerful, loving God. Of course, why do they say that? Well, if evolution is true and the Bible is true, like theistic evolutionists try to say, then that means that there was a lot of death leading up to Adam, and then death just continued from there. That would mean that God actually created a world full of death and suffering. So, of course, we also know that the Bible specifically states that death did not come into the world until after the sin of Adam. And of course, the wages of sin is death. So, again, once again, we see that theistic evolution is completely incompatible with what the Bible says. All right, so number three, in theistic evolution, the Bible is regarded as a collection of documents which partially contains God's word. The Bible thus contains no authoritative binding truths, but must be freshly interpreted and corrected for every era and in every situation. So they view parts of the Bible as God's word and parts of the Bible as mythology. So which ones do you get to decide are God's word and what's mythology? You know, and for the theistic evolution, it's whatever is convenient at the time, whatever fits their theory, the way that they want everything to fit together, that part is history, but the rest is not. So, you know, once again, you're getting into human opinions. You know, you're not taking the Bible for how it was written. You're taking it for, you know, as if it was just another Iliad, you know, just another book of mythology. And as Bible-believing Christians, that, of course, is not something that we should do, obviously. Almost goes without saying. All right. But apparently, we do have to say something about it. All right, guys, that is all for Answers in Genesis. Let's move on to Got Questions. Love Got Questions. I agree with probably 95% of the stuff that they say on their channel and in their website. The little 5% that I don't agree with are on minor things. The major issues, I'd say, I agree with Got Questions. So I love their channel. They're awesome. You know, so anyway, let's see what they have to say. Theistic evolutionists imagine a Darwinian scenario in which stars evolved, then our solar system, then Earth, then plants and animals, and eventually man. The two viewpoints within theistic evolution disagree as to the role God played in the unfolding of events, but they generally agree on the Darwinian timeline. That timeline is in conflict with a literal interpretation of the Genesis creation account. Regardless of how a person chooses to interpret scientific evidence or the Bible, experience has shown the Bible to be reliable. Centuries of challenges have affirmed that not only is the Bible compatible with science, but also that not a single word in the Bible has ever been disproved by confirmed facts. Interpretations of Scripture may be found lacking, but the Word of God itself is never wrong. The Bible is God's living Word given to us by the Creator of the universe, and his description of how he created that universe is not threatened by atheistic versions of science. So that's basically evolution is. It's the atheistic version of science. It's a philosophy. It's not just a scientific theory. It's a philosophy, and it's mainly propagated by atheists. It was created by an atheist, somebody who wanted to basically stick it to the church, and you know, you're trying to mix that in with the holy word of God, and you know, it's going to fail every time. So, and then one of the worst things of it all is that when theistic evolution and the Bible do contradict, somebody who believes in theistic evolution is almost always going to change the Bible before they change their science. So science is taking precedence over God's word. And that's a very sad thing indeed. Proverbs 30 verse 6 says, "Do not add to his words, lest he rebuke you and you be found a liar." The Bible specifically warns us against adding to Scripture. So, guys, let's stay on that straight and narrow path. Let's stick to God's word, not be intimidated by the worldly philosophies that are trying to creep their way into the church. And as long as we follow God's word, guys, we're going to be on the right path. We're on the right path to Jesus. Love you guys. Take care. Bye-bye.